as a young artist, this Melkbos Strand used to be my most favorite place to come and take out the black mussels you have here. And one of the reasons I really like them is because they used to grow like big as bricks. I mean, you had to eat them like a chop with a knife and fork. And I think the reason is there, Kuberg behind me, the nuclear power station, because one day when I was collecting them, there was a guy sitting next to me and he was collecting water in a test tube. And I said, "Hey, what are you doing?" He said, "I'm just checking the water that there's no radioactivity." But there is, and it makes for brilliant eating. How's it? I am your Malchat kitchen boy, and this is my famous Kitchmobile. Let me show you what I can do. To start with, I cook like a god, there's no question about it, even if some people think it's a bit kinky. And I know what I'm talking about. This is one of the biggest private cookbook libraries in the country. And I'm a famous artist, and I draw like a dream, so that I can illustrate my vast culinary expertise. So come with me in the Kitchmobile and let's go and set the sea on fire. Well, it's small town. You come up for air and they push you back down. C-11. C-11. I'm caught between the angels and God devil. Put something there. Like that. More than me. This is the Kitchmobile, my co-star and my partner in crime.
And we're gonna put these horns on the car.
What do you think? You don't think it'll be a bit much, eh? Well, I don't want people to think that I'm trying too hard, you know?
You're actually supposed to wind dry these. I don't think my forefathers had exactly this in mind.
But there. Don't you think that makes a perfect decoration?
A fish is such an aesthetic thing. It's such a shame that they go and cut up this fish because it has such a beautiful shape with a head and the sleek tail and the little fork. As a piece of design, it's so beautiful that you cannot improve on it. I hate dust roads. I hate, why do these paternoster people have to live by the sea but with a dust road? Why can't they just go down this, you know, drive on the wet beach or something? You know, how much we're gonna have to drink in the paternoster pub because of all this dust.
Is he a fisherman here?
Yeah, ik is a fisherman ook ja.
Is it?
Maar jy kan nie met R3 'n snoek lewe nie en jy koop hom in die Kaap vir R30.
Maar jy het nou 'n boot.
Ek het 'n boot gehad, ek het hom nie meer. Dis die boot te werk.
Lovely man. Lovely. But it's a hard life too. Really, it's an unforgiving sea that, look at that. Life's tough, you know, if you're not me, if you don't live for only the lacquer cray, the little sniggering things. The kids are discovering the fish on there. Non-Manera, what time are you going out?
That
is the only way to get to St Helena Bay. And look at it. You wouldn't say that this quiet little bay houses more than 50% of the South African fishing industry. I'm sure we're going to find our snook there. Lekker vis, meneer. Ah, jullie lekker gevangen. How do you choose a good one? Show me how to choose a quality snook.
You always take the most flexible snook. Must do that.
Why is that?
Because if it's stiff, it's on the verge of getting fucked.
This is known internationally as a snake mackerel.
Snake mackerel.
That's what it's called. And when it bites you, the blood doesn't coagulate. You take the eye and you squeeze the eye on the wound.
Yeah.
To stop the bleeding.
To stop the bleeding.
Yeah.
Beautiful, look at that. So you bought it for R3 a fish, and then how much does it sell for in the shops about?
In the fisheries?
Yeah.
About 12 rand a kilo, 15 rand a kilo.
There you are, Steve Walters, cook snook. Oh, this is crazy. This'll blow your tan off, man. This viscus bin by. Waar wille vrachtags woes by. Cultivate these. Do you have any size restriction on them?
No.
I see you call them cocktail paddlemen. What do they do with all these things, the skirt that they have on the end? So basically it's a snail. It doesn't sense me, clearly.
Well, it's used to being handled.
Are they?
They actually get tame, yeah.
They get tame?
They do.
No, don't tell me that. Shame. They're such fun to stroke. Is that why? They're so slippery. How does he eat?
They eat with knife.
Okay.
But you can see they've got like a tongue and they rasp away the leaf.
So where's their tongue? Can you see it? Is that thing that...
That's a mouth.
Oh, you got to show that. You got to see this little thing, okay? That's the tongue. It's called a radula, isn't it?
That's right.
Right, see, I'm not as stupid as I look. Okay, let's put this little boy back into the water. I actually thought I was playing with a girl all along. I'm about to show you how you really cook paddlemoon. We've got these little baby paddlemoon, or cocktail abalone as they call it here in the farm where we got it. We're here in Jacobsbaai, beautiful little place. And what we're going to do is we're going to steam it like the Japanese do. All seafood really just needs to be heated through, just to change its texture. It doesn't have to cook. This is why the locals here, they do it, they moor it on the rocks, they scour it, they hammer it, and then after 4 hours cooking, they mince it, just to make sure. And that is the very reason they don't get it right. I'm going to use this little smoker, which is perfect for it. It's got a little rack. You can do it in an ordinary pot with a tight-fitting lid, or you can put some stones underneath. Okay, I'm just going to use seawater to steam it with, if I don't fall into the water myself. So there, and there. And I'm going to put the lid on. Once the water boils under the rack, to get it steaming, put them on their backs. Close it tightly. And I'm going to do it just for a little bit, just to heat it through, really. I find this seaweed quite interesting. Beautiful color it has when it's wet. But when it dries, it becomes almost black, like here on the rock. Okay, look at that. I find it very much like the Japanese nori. So I'm going to use this as a garnish with the abalone. Let me see how it's doing. About 8 or 10 minutes later, you can check if they're cooked. This is it. Let's check in there. Take this right off. The test is to see if they can come out of the shelf. So I'm just going to stick my finger in there, and it comes out very easily. Okay, I'm going to take them out and I'll show you how I'm going to eat them. I'm going to make a bit of wasabi with it, which is what the Japanese use with their sashimi. I'm going to add some soy sauce to it. And with a little bit of that seaweed, this, and we're going to have a little meal on the rocks. Thin slices, okay? They have a beautiful texture. They're very gelatinous. I'm going to dip it in there. And I'm going to have it with a hoppy of the seaweed too, okay? Delicious. Can I show our camera, our sound man, try that? And then take a small hoppy of that. If you don't see this, it means we've all died. What do you think?
It's great.
Huh?
Kaja, as you say in Bushman land.
I just don't know why people rape food so often, you know. I think it's a question of not understanding it properly. To know that they're not really, all they're doing is they're changing the texture of it if they cook it. So once it's heated through, it's changed. Yeah. And it's not gonna, can't change more. It's like heating a rock, you know? It stays like that. Ahoy there! This is Don Ellis's boat, the Derby. And we're coming to pick up the crew so that they can film the incredible wonders of Kitchenboy up the Berg River. Okay, what's this place coming up here, Dan?
This is one of the traditional West Coast fish houses. This is where they salt the fish and hang them out to dry. You can see in front of the building, there's a pole standing up, and that's a drying rack. Fish get caught here in the river and in the bay. So the majority of the community in Feld River are actually fishermen.
I've taken the liberty of putting one on a skewer, and I came armed. Most people think when they braai something and they wrap it in foil and all that, they're actually braaiing it. I'm going to show you that it's actually steaming the fish. So we have our grunter there, right? And it's got a pig nose. Some people actually call it a pig nose grunter, like that. It's got very sharp fins here. Be careful when you clean it. You can actually, they're serrated, they can hurt you very much. It's also got very sharp fins up there. I'm going to wrap it in banana leaves. Once the whole thing is inside a parcel, when it's been wrapped up, there's the fish, there's the parcel around it, and there's some liquid in there, even the natural liquid inside the fish, and also some of the flavorings we're gonna add to it. There's gonna be a lot of steam going around inside there. And when you heat it at the bottom, the fish is actually going to steam inside. I love the notion of being naughty sometimes, the whole little mischievous thing about flavoring food. And the fact that the grunter lives or loves prawns so much, I thought I'm going to flavor it with prawns. Banana leaves are wonderful wrapping things. This is a very young St Lucia. You can see it's still rolled up. And the way to get it pliable is to put it in the fire or on any heat. I'm just going to wave it through there. You'll see it getting limp. Otherwise, it won't become pliable enough to wrap. Sauce, provide the saltiness, and most important, the Indian Ocean masala. Mind the fins, the fins don't prick the thing, because the idea is to trap this steam in there. Can't have any holes pricked in it. Now it's just a question of putting the parcel on the fire. Not too hot, the cold. You can even put some stones on it, or a grid for that matter. You may wonder why I have these green bananas here, but green bananas are still starch. The starch hasn't been converted to sugar yet. So you can actually cook them like potatoes in the fire. So what I'm going to do as accompaniment to this fish is I'm going to make a salsa. One of the things that they'd never use as a salad here are these green papayas. I've got a little trick that I once saw in a movie, the scent of the green papaya. The whole idea with this trick is to convert the flesh into noodles. Voila, now I take this and I go like that. It's got a wonderful bland taste, crispiness, that goes well with salad. 90% of South Africa's pineapples grows here in the Slusluwe area. We're going to use pineapple bits and we're going to make a little basket out of it. So we added the pineapple here to the bits of green papaya. I'm going to squeeze in these marvelous guavadillas. Just look how much juice they have. So I'm going to overdo it a little bit, so that is going to be the dominant flavor. And now, of course, we've got to put in some chili. There's it, lots of chili. I'm not scared of the chili with this. Also gives it color. I'm going to put in a little bit of ginger. And the most important thing, which is going to blend the whole salsa, is I'm going to put sugar in. Looks like quite a lot, but don't worry, I'm going to put an equal amount of white vinegar in there. You can put just plain lemon in, but I'm not going to because it already has a lot of fruity acidity. Now you toss it with your fingers like this, just to make sure that the flavors all mix, and then you serve it in that pineapple that we hollowed out. And then I'm going to put a few sprigs of red pepper on, just to make it more attractive. There's our tropical salsa with guavadilla, and the juice is running out and I'm not letting it. That's delicious. And it's hot. Look what I just brought in from the sea. Banana leaf steamed spotted grunter with some prawns and a beautiful salsa made with pineapples, guavadilla, and some roasted green bananas. We're in Durban, it's the end of June, and that means one thing, sardine run.
We're doing this for years. For years, it's what, 140 years now, from my great-grandfather's time. There was times that we applied for license to have a motorboat on this beach. They turned us down. Oh. And that's how we start operating with this banana boat, yeah, from the old people's time.
I don't think you will ever get sardines fresher than this. They're very oily inside. They're going to be absolutely perfect to grill. The Portuguese, what they like doing, they put it... And you can eat the skin, by the way. I nearly threw it away. This area of Durban is called Blue Lagoon, and a lot of fish, especially those loving brackish water, come into this area. And this in particular is a very well-known fish all over the world, so it's got a cold. What do you call this, Ravin?
We call it a springer, but I think the other name for it is a skipjack.
Sports fishermen are the only people who get these, and you are unlikely to encounter it in a fish shop. But Ravin's other fish, and I've been nagging him, to sell it to me. This is a pompano. This is arguably the greatest fish in the world. It's one of the kingfish family, which you can see. It's got a smooth, it seems almost scaleless. It's probably the most expensive fish in the East. They will kill for it. It really is fantastic. You can use it in any possible way, from smoking to frying to grilling and so on. If I found a woman who looked like this, I'd marry her. See, I mean it. It's a beautiful fish, Ravi. Congratulations. Okay. And fuck you that you don't want to sell it to me. I'm sorry about that. And such are the adventures of Kitchenboy in his perpetual quest to save the world from bad taste.